Imam al-Baqir was born on the 57th year of the Hijrah, towards the end of the Khilafat of Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan. Muawiyah passed on the Khilafat to Yazid, his son. And as we know, Imam al-Husayn, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, rose on the plains of Karbala with his famous words that a man like me does not pledge allegiance to a man like him. And as we know, Imam al-Husayn was martyred. Imam al-Baqir was present at Karbala at the age of 3.5. Usually, at that young age, you want your experiences to be experiences of love. You want your experiences to be experiences of warmth. You want your experiences to be experiences of comfort. You want your experiences to be experiences of happiness. Imam al-Baqir, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, had to witness an event like Karbala. He was not necessarily outside the tent, but within the tent he would see what's happening. On one side he'd see his father very ill. On the other side he'd see Sayyida Zainab running from one tent to another. He'd see Aunt Rabab running from one tent to another. He'd see Umm Kulthum running from one tent to another. And he himself had to run from one tent to another. Why? Because the horses were galloping on the children of Al Muhammad. Imam al-Baqir was taken. He was chained to Sayyida Ruqayya, Sayyida Sukaina, and the other children of Al Muhammad. And they were taken from Karbala to Kufa, and from Kufa to Sham. In Sham, Imam al-Baqir, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, spoke his first words of knowledge in front of Yazid. Yazid was sitting down on his throne. He looked at Sayyida Zainab. He looked at Sayyida Ruqayya. He looked at Sayyida Sukaina. He looked at Rabab. He looked at Umm Kulthum. And he said, do you know what I'm going to do to all of you? Some of you are sell off as slaves. The others, I'm going to kill you one by one. The place became silent. Suddenly somebody spoke and said, oh Yazid, when Fir'aun was in power and he caught Musa and Harun, Fir'aun at least asked the people, what should I do with them? To which they replied, let them go live far away. Yet you, Yazid, have no respect for the family of the person of the Prophet who brought this religion. The people looked around. They wanted to know who said these words. As in, it's not ordinary. They saw a 3.5-year-old child say these words. It's not ordinary that a 3-year-old has the knowledge of Pharaoh, of Moses, and of Harun alayhi salam. They were later released. Narrations mention they returned to Karbala, and then they went to the holy city of Medina. In Medina, there was a person waiting to send salams from Rasulullah to Imam al-Baqir. Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari was the oldest surviving companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Narrations mention he lived up until the age of 90. Others mention that he lived up until the age of 93. And as we know, he was very close to Ahlul Bayt, as in he was the person that narrated Hadith al-Kisa. He was a companion of Rasulullah. He was a companion of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Qaid al-Ghurr al-Muhajjaleen, Asadullah al-Ghalib, Ali ibn Abi Talib. He was a companion of Imam al-Hasan. He was a companion of Imam al-Husayn, Imam al-Sajjad. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said to him, oh Jabir, one day you will meet a young man whose name is like my name and whose attributes are like my attributes, and who has nur shining from his face, and who has knowledge and wisdom like none other. His name is Al-Baqir, send my salams to him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sends his salams to Imam Al-Baqir. What does Al-Baqir mean? Baqir comes from the word Baqr. Baqr, what does it mean? When a farmer rips open his farmland, or when a farmer rips open his soil, it's called Baqr. Imam Al-Baqir, because he ripped, he split, he scrutinized, and he spread knowledge, he was given the title Al-Baqir. And because in a time when different schools of thought were emerging, people used to go to him to seek knowledge on the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. One day a man came up to Imam Al-Baqir and said to him, Baqir. Baqir means cow. Imam Al-Baqir said to him, no, my title is Al-Baqir. He said to him, your mother, her job is a cook. He said, that is her profession. He said to him, your mother, she's a black lady, shame on you. Imam Al-Baqir said to him, if you are telling the truth, then may God forgive you. And if you are lying, then may God forgive you. Allahu Akbar. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Narrations mention that Imam Al-Baqir faced numerous amounts of khalifas from Bani Umayyah. Abdul Malik bin Marwan, how was he as Khalifa? He employed Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi as his governor. Hajjaj, how was he? Hajjaj, as we know, said his famous words that I wish I was present on the 10th of Muharram in Karbala so I could have been the person that beheaded the grandson of Rasulullah. Hajjaj comes on Eid al-Adha. He sees what the people are doing. He asks them, what do you do on Eid al-Adha? They said, we sacrifice animals. He said, very well, get me every Ali. Get me every Hassan. And get me every Hussein. Let's sacrifice them as well. You think the father was bad? Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik, his son, the great Khalifa of Islam, Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik, what does he do? The people come up to him and say to him, Sulaiman, lead Salat al-Jum'ah. As in, people expect you to lead Salat al-Jum'ah. You're the Khalifa of the time. He'd look at them and say, are you joking? Do you expect me to lead Salat al-Jum'ah? I have two women waiting for me in my room. Let somebody else go and lead this prayer. He used to have two women always around him. One by the name of Salama and one by the name of Hababa. Imam Al-Baqir took this to his advantage. How? He saw these are the most unreligious khalifas, so he took this to his advantage by spreading the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some khalifas were affected positively by the Imam. For example, Umar bin Abdul Aziz was affected positively. Up until the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz, Khutbat al-Jum'ah would begin in the name of God, the most beneficent, the most merciful. May God curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. Umar bin Abdul Aziz was the person responsible in stopping the cursing of Ali ibn Abi Talib on the pulpits due to the effect that Imam Al-Baqir had on him. That one day he was speaking to his father and he'd say, whenever my father would mention the name of Ali ibn Abi Talib, he'd start to become nervous. So I would say to him, my father, why do you, when you speak about any other man, you're calm. But when you mention the name of Ali, you become nervous. He said to him, my son, if the people knew the merits of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they wouldn't have us as their khalifas or as their leaders. Umar bin Abdul Aziz was responsible for returning the Yusuf land of Fadak back to Ahlul Bayt. Again, following the advice of Imam Al-Baqir. Then there was Hisham bin Abdul Malik. Hisham bin Abdul Malik. One day he was sitting next to the Kaaba with Nafi'. Nafi' was this ex-slave of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And he was one of the Khawarij who fought Ali ibn Abi Talib at Nahrawan. Imam al-Baqir enters the Kaaba. The people make way for him. Nafi' looks at Hisham and says, who's that? He says, that's the prophet of the people of Iraq. They call him al-Baqir. Apparently he can split knowledge and he can answer questions nobody else can answer. Nafi' said, very well, leave him to me. Nafi' goes up to the Imam, he says to him, al-Baqir, come here. Imam Baqir comes. He says to him, apparently the people say you are knowledgeable. Imam says to him with this wonderful reply, that I am not of the ignorant. I am not of the ignorant. He tells the Imam, I have a question for you. Let's see if you are knowledgeable. Imam says to him, go ahead. He says, what was the difference in years between Prophet Jesus and Prophet Muhammad? Imam says to him, in your opinion, 600, in mine, 500. How does the Imam know his opinion? Then he says to him, very well, in Surah 43, verse 45, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Prophet, O Messenger, ask the prophets from before, did they tell their people to believe in other than God? Muhammad, how is that possible that Allah tells Prophet Muhammad to ask the prophets from before? That's impossible. Imam al-Baqir looked at him and said, on the night of Mi'raj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let the prophets lead all the prophets in prayer. And after the prayer, Rasulullah turned around and said to them, he asked them, did you tell your people to believe in other than God? To which they replied, no. Nafi' said, you're good. When did God come about? Imam said to him, show me when he was not, and I'll show you when he came. What an answer. The Imam wanted to finish him off. He had enough of his questions. He said to him, Nafi', I hear you're from the Khawarij. Nafi' says, yes. He says, I have a question for you. Do you agree with the Khawarij that fought Ali ibn Abi Talib at Nahrawan? Because I'm going to give you two answers, and these are the two answers that you can give me. If you agree, then you are a disbeliever, because fighting the Khalifa of your time is kufr. And if you disagree, then you are a disbeliever, because Nafi', you are one of them who fought Ali ibn Abi Talib. So now, which one of the two are you? The Umayyad Khulafa had enough of the Imam. So what they started to do was spread the poison in his food. They started to put needles in his saddle so that the needles would go into the Imam's thighs. And the Imam passed away from the poisoning. But he leaves us with these words that when they ask him, who are the followers of Imam al-Baqir? He says, there are three categories. Number one, the first category is they follow us, but they rely and depend on others. Number two, the second category, they're like glass. All they do is they look at themselves as a reflection and they don't do nothing about it. And the third type, they are like gold. Why like gold? Because the more they suffer, the more they shine. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وآل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين